It's already.
Now, two questions for you. Were you able to hear that? And was it looking pixelated?
Here, yes. The quality was.
The quality on Zoom is always a bit. we can try and see if someone else. Oh, I see Taylor's here, actually. So, Sarah, you're good if you want.
I resent the link. I just saw Henry ask for the link again. I resent it twice.
Okay. I wasn't sure if you were joining this one, Taylor. So we had
No problem.
Sarah, shoot me a message on WhatsApp afterwards. And if Taylor can try and do the videos, we'll see if that looks better on her side.
Okay.
Because I think you have a better internet connection, Taylor. So. Do you have the videos at hand, Taylor, or should I need to resend them to you?
I thought I had. Can you send me the link on Slack? Although I think I have.
Well, just if you could just communicate with Sarah, make sure you've got the right videos, and I'll just do everything else with the others. Make sure everyone else is okay. So I think we have everyone in here.
Is host 1000? Oh, we have two hosts 1000. Is Halfdan on the call?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me?
Okay, Halfdan, maybe if you could just rename your
name.
Yeah. You're showing up as host 1000.
Okay, yeah. Let me see. Rename, yeah.
Taylor, I've just sent you the link to the PowerPoints.
Hello.
Okay, so everyone sounds good. Everyone looks good. We have two Henrys.
You're a real charmer. Thank you.
There we go. And we'll just, does anyone want to double check screen sharing from their side? Is everyone using slides?
Yeah.
Mine is the moderator.
Okay, those are the sharing. If you want to double check and share, feel free. If
I would like to just prepare.
Yes. Sure.
Hey, good morning, James. A great day yesterday.
Yeah, we were really happy. I hope Anil enjoyed himself. I thought the press conference and the opening went well.
It went exceedingly well. He was very pleased. Your moderator did a great job. All good.
What you don't see is behind the scenes when we're calling the president 5 minutes before saying, where's the president? Is he coming? But, you know, that's kind of what you expect when you have these high-level political speakers, right?
Yeah.
But no, the leaders did great, so we're really happy with that.
I'm just going to check that I share my screen okay and you guys can see it okay. Bear with me if that's okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Up. Yep, presentation mode.
You see okay?
I could see it in regular mode. Go to presentation mode.
How's that? You see it now?
Not the presentation mode.
Okay, let me just, I'll stop sharing and let's try again.
I have a question. I'm on the Islands Pathable Meet Ellen, the Future of Clean Maritime Transport page, And I'm trying to upload my presentation in case that comes in handy, but I can't see an upload button. You
see a manage button in the top right-hand corner?
Manage, yeah.
Yeah, and if you click on that, there'll be a files button, and under there you should see an upload.
Yeah, I already watched you do this on YouTube, so.
I'll just stop sharing now if I can.
You're good, Dean.
Yes, right, Dean. Okay,
I'll just stop.
Anybody else want to share their deck?
Yes, I would try to do. But then Dean need to close down,
yeah,
maybe.
I'm just trying to do that. I apologize.
Okay.
Stop sharing, I assume. Stop. I think I've stopped now.
Yep.
Oh, do you see my first slide?
Perfect.
Yeah,
yes.
Good.
Good to go.
Very good. Halfdan, do you want to share yours and
sure.
Make sure you're comfortable?
Sure.
Sphere, we need you to stop sharing.
Yeah, and I lost my... it's in Zoom, is it?
Sorry, I can do it from my side.
Okay, yeah. I can do...
I can stop you sharing. I can't start you sharing, but I can stop you sharing.
No.
And I'm just going to add your organizations to your names. So.
Can you see mine now, my front page?
Yep.
All right.
Yes.
Good. The upload button, I can't make it work in the manage files. It just doesn't react.
Okay. We have those, I think. So we should be able
didn't
to.
You, didn't you send in your deck a couple days ago, Halfdan?
Yeah, it's been modified, I'm afraid. Can I send it to you now, Henry?
Well, I'm not the guy that needs it.
Yeah, if you want to send it over to me, I don't know what you're using. I'm surprised that, not sure why that isn't working, but I think it's not the most urgent thing to upload it there, but if you are able to send it, we can. If not, I think it's fine.
I have the videos ready. I'm looking at the panelist guide. I don't see where it says when each video plays, like when I should play each video.
Okay, firstly, let's just test them. Do you want to...
Okay. Yeah.
Well, after Halfdan's, I'm not sure what's happening on Halfdan's screen.
And maybe Taylor, you learn a verbal cue from our speakers as to like you to run the video.
Okay.
Yeah, so, for me, I'll give you a standby. There's only the one main video, MP4 to go. So I'll just give you the standby on that. I'll say a few words and then go.
What? One is with Dean and one is with Halfdan, and they'll both say they're about to play a video. So it could be fairly obvious, I think, as long as you make sure we get them the right way around. I just want to, if you can play them.
Can I go ahead and cut off this person who's sharing their screen?
Halfdan, are you happy?
Me?
Yeah. No problem.
I will request a video after slide 5 where I talk about charging and power use. But I will, of course, say. James, I just sent you the presentation. I hope I didn't murder your inbox. It's 30 megabytes, so.
Yeah, I'll try to download it.
Okay, I'm gonna play this now. Can you hear that?
Yeah, it's pretty loud.
Beautiful. Too loud?
I did the music, by the way, so don't say anything mean about it. It's a bit cheesy, but that's the way it's supposed to be.
I think that'll be fine, Taylor, if you just make sure that the screen around it disappears when it's playing, because we could see the play button and everything.
This part, you mean?
Yeah, just so when it starts playing, make sure that all disappears.
Yeah, okay.
So I think it was just because you were hovering over it.
Yeah, it is.
So that's Halfdan's video?
We have 4 videos.
Halfdan, you only have 1 video, correct?
I think it's just that we got the same video twice.
I believe too.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, we got a high res and a low res one.
Right. Well, let me see. Which one was I just watching, man?
So that was the correct one for Halfdan.
Okay. Oh, yeah, that's the high res one. Okay. Then we have...
You have one second one for Dean.
Yes, one second.
Okay. Get them on.
Let me share my screen again. Oh, so this must be the lower performance one then.
Yeah. So actually, I think you should use that lower res one because that looked a bit smoother. The res isn't going to make a difference in the video. And when you just played that second one, it looked a bit smoother. So okay. use the one that you've just played when Halfdan talks.
Okay, so then now we have this one. Where is that? There we go.
Perfect. Yeah.
I'm hearing it.
Yeah, that looks good.
Okay, awesome. And now one more, which is, let's see.
There are no other videos, Taylor.
No, that's it. Yeah.
I think it's just the same version of that one.
No? Oh, we just have a couple versions of the same thing. Okay, got it.
Okay. So yeah, just use that one that you just played, and Dean will give a verbal cue when the video is ready. But obviously, you can get it ready when he comes on to the... Dean, is it? It's not going to be right at the start, is it? Or
no, it's basically there'll be a grey screen at slide number 5. I'll have a few sentences. When you see that grey screen, just prepare. I've got a very few sentences, and just ask you to play the video.
Oh, so you're both on slide 5.
The video comes in at about 6:30 into his presentation.
Yeah.
Six. Okay, got it. If he talked at the same speed as you timed it.
Right.
Absolutely.
If he does.
It might speed up with nerves.
I'm Scottish. I might talk a little bit quicker. You know?
Okay, that's good. That's fine.
I see another video that's different from both of those.
Dean, I just had a meeting with Scottish Transport Authorities in Glasgow, and they were interested in Ellen.
So okay, maybe
we'll see Ellen 2 up there.
Maybe we'll have to do I can control this one here from the, we don't have to do that. I can do that from the, and talk over that one. So that's no problem. Okay.
This is nothing to do with that video that Taylor just played. Mm-hmm.
That one will be embedded. It is embedded.
It's embedded. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure I'm not missing anything. Okay.
No. And the order of the two videos will be in the order of the speakers. Dean will be the first speaker after Charlin introduced him. His video will rack up first, and then later on.
Okay, perfect.
Charlin, I think you indicated before, you have no slides, or do you have something prepared?
No slides.
Okay. Just your natural intellect and ability to run the panel.
That is right.
Excellent. Fantastic. Well, we have 5 whole minutes to kill now. Unless anyone has anything else they need to ask or check, I think we're all set.
In that case, obviously, I know, Charlin, you're going to introduce everybody. Do you want me to bring up my first slide so that we've got some? I don't have to stutter going into it ultimately, or so we've got something to kick off, or.
Oh, so I think what we had agreed is when I start introducing you, you could already start sharing your screen and just leave on your first slide until you're introduced.
Understood.
If you could just play that again. Sorry, could you just put that back up again? I want to check something.
Sure.
And if you go to present. So we see what you see with the notes and the whole screen around it. So you need to click on display settings at the top.
And switch them around.
Yeah, just to make sure. I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, there we go.
Yep.
Okay.
Dean, do you want to print off your comments unless you have
No, them? I have another screen, so I'll just swap myself around.
Good.
As long as you can see me, and then I'm good. I'll just swap myself around. That's okay.
James, do you want me to leave this area and log in as a user, or doesn't matter?
It's up to you. Me and Taylor will still be here, just with our videos muted and camera off. So if you want to experience it as a user and see it from that side, it might be helpful, or stay just in case you want to jump.
I'll back out. Good luck, everybody. Break a leg.
Thank you.
Cheers. You don't need to leave.
Cheers.
I should be able to just demote you. Oh, he's gone. Wonderful, everyone. Well, this will be good. Looking forward to it. I'm going to disappear off screen as well now. So are we going to leave this on for the welcome, Dean? Is that the plan?
Oh, yeah, I can take it off. That's no problem. It's off now,
okay.
I assume. Is it still off, yeah?
Stop sharing. Yeah, there we go.
Okay, good, good.
So I'm wondering, James, help us here. Should he go into presentation mode before he shares his screen so that when he's on, he doesn't have to fumble to go into presentation mode?
That would be better if you can. Dean, I don't know if that's possible on the device that you're using, like to have it already in presentation mode, just so you can go straight in.
It should be.
Because it does depend on the device.
Yeah. Now I have to, yes, okay. Yeah, it should be. Should be able to do that. Yeah. Bear with me.
And Charlin, you know what you're doing with questions and where to receive them?
Yes, sir.
I will just say that we've been having questions, which probably wasn't in your practice, but questions have also been coming in through the Zoom chat as well as the Pathable chat, which has thrown me slightly because it wasn't what we expected. So just so you know, it will be, but what I can do, if you just want to look in one place, if you have the Pathable chat in front of you, I can just copy questions from one to the other, or if you just want them both, that's fine.
I could try to monitor both, but I would prefer, I mean, if you could assist and have them transferred over to the Pathable page, that's fine. So I'll be looking at the polls tab.
Yeah, and the polls tab, yes, but I would also say the chat. Okay, how about, Charlin, that you just look at the chat on the Zoom? That might be easier, because if things are coming in different places, then I can just put everything there for you. Would that work?
Well, what I had understood was that the poll also allows us to see which questions were more popular.
Yes. Yeah, that's true. We can use that.
I'll keep vigilant with both.
Okay, great. Yeah. And if anyone wants to communicate, you can send a message in through the all panelists. Great. So people are going to join in now. I'll count you in. Welcome, everyone. We'll be starting in about 1 minute. Welcome, everyone just joining. We'll get started in about 30 seconds. Okay, Charlin, you can take it away. Thank you. Charlin, we can't hear you.
Good morning, all. Sorry about that. Now devices are all set to go. I was saying good morning to all and good afternoon, depending on what part of the world you're joining in from. Welcome to this session. Meet Ellen, the future of clean maritime transport, and quite an elegant title for our panel discussion here today. I assure you, as exciting as the title sounds, the presentations that make up this panel discussion will also be quite exciting. I mean, just thinking about the title of this panel, Meet Ellen. Again, thinking about the energy space, sustainability, we think of gender and energy. And that gives me a great segue to introduce myself, Charlin Bodley, project development and gender expert with the Caribbean Center for Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency, the CREEE. And the CREEE is just one of roughly 10 centers that make up a global network of sustainable energy centers around the world. And like its sister center, PCREEE, you can imagine that the CREEE, through its mandate and vision, quite understands the island context, as we serve many island states with our mandates. So at the CREEE, our aim is to transform the energy sector into one that's sustainable, climate resilient, and affordable, and all with the aim of, although this may sound cliche, but really it is with the aim of transforming lives. And I think this fits so excellently into this panel discussion. Meeting Ellen, is she really the future of clean maritime transport? It's a good time for me to recognize the sponsors of this session, Leclanché. I hope my French has done this some justice. A name that's known within this sector and the sector in which most of us, and I'm sure those attending, work. And so this name is no stranger to you, synonymous with quality for sure. Sea transportation is really a huge livelihood factor for island states and island regions. The Caribbean being one, the Pacific region, and of course, many other island states in the world. Of course, it's not unique to island states, but because of the uniqueness and vulnerabilities that island nations share, one can understand how crucial it is for trade, for regional integration, and ultimately for economic development. However, we are aware that island states still fall victim to unaffordable, unsustainable modes of maritime transport, and in the worst of cases, even non-existent. So there is definitely strong potential for application across many sectors, including the tourism sectors, as many island nations depend so heavily on tourism. And it really boils down to the triple bottom line: people, profit, and the planet. And today's presentations will really bring out these three areas. How are the recent technological advancements in the maritime space and industry, how are they helping us to save the environment, to do much better, to meet our international commitments in reducing CO2 emissions? How are they helping to transform the lives of our people socially? What are the economic benefits? And the CREEE, as the center, the implementation hub for energy in the Caribbean region, along with its partner CARICOM Energy Program, is leading the development of a regional electric vehicle strategy. And with that strategy, we must consider what we perceive to be the pillars of a transition. And this, of course, applies to the maritime space. And so I think our presentations that will follow will definitely touch on these pillars, and they include technology and infrastructure as one. Secondly, finance, market development and innovation. Regulation and policy. And last but not least, and as we meet Ellen, I'm sure we're going to hear a little more about how Ellen has impacted the people and what was required. And it really means that we take Ellen from the lab into the sea, into the land, into the life of the people. And so with that comes, of course, gleaning what's necessary, where capacity development and awareness is considered. And so without further ado, I hope this introduction has given you just a snapshot of what you can expect these discussion points to be featured in our presentations today. And so it is my great pleasure to introduce our first speaker as we look at the technological aspects of electrifying our maritime transport space. And it's no other than Mr. Dean Jennings. And Mr. Jennings is the Vice President of eMarine Leclanché. He is by far an accomplished marine industry executive with over 10 years engineering, business development, and management experience. Having joined Leclanché in October of 2018, as the vice president of the company's e-marine business and part of his e-transport group, he is responsible for the complete direction of the business, including product development, sales, engineering, and customer support. Previously, Dean was regional sales manager of communication systems at Eaton, marketing its hazardous area communications portfolio. And prior to joining Eaton, he served as sales manager offshore production systems for Kongsberg Maritime, delivering marine automation systems to the oil and gas sector. Jennings spent more than 11 years at ABB Marine, another big name in the industry, rising in the ranks from senior installation and commissioning service engineer to serving as technical account manager. He began his career serving in the British Royal Navy for 10 years on minesweeping frigates. Dean graduated from the Royal Navy School of Engineering with a Bachelor of Science in Marine Electrical Engineering, and allow me to wish him the very best as he is currently pursuing an MBA. Over to you, Dean.
Thank you very much, Charlin. Good morning, good afternoon, and welcome to an introduction to Ellen. As Charlin says, my name is Dean Jennings. Now, let your mind wander for a second, because what you're about to witness here is a global first. What we've created is the world's first 100% electric ferry, and at the time, the world's largest. And when I say electric, I mean everything from the drives, from the motors, from the thrusters, from the lighting, from the coffee machine, everything. She can carry 200 passengers, 31 cars, or 5 trucks and 8 cars. She is non-polluting. No CO2, no sulfur dioxide. Let me tell you, I've sailed on her, and there's zero pollution, there's zero noise, significantly much less vibration, which gives the passengers much more comfort. My goal in this presentation is to give you an introduction into Ellen and the technology that made her possible. First, I'll provide you a little bit of background on our heartbeat, the Leclanché system. A short introduction to the Leclanché then. We have been providing energy storage solutions since 1909, so we've been around for quite some time. The company discontinued the production of alkaline batteries and reconverted to lithium-ion technology with a massive investment over the last decade. Our state-of-the-art facility in Germany, delivering our pouch cell technology for both lithium titanate oxide and GNMC chemistries, with a new module manufacturing line in our HQ in Switzerland, to fully industrialize the process for this electrification revolution. A key differentiator for our clients and the reason they come to us is, we're a fully turnkey integrated system provider for high energy and high power cells, battery management systems, remote logging, and it's all from one provider and one European provider at that. We have three main business units that make up Leclanché: the stationary business, providing supplementary grid applications, speciality, delivering custom batteries for a wide range of smaller sectors, And finally, but not least, the e-transport business unit, providing high cycle and high energy density battery solutions for the marine, rail, and commercial vehicle applications. Okay, so why, Ellen, and why is this relevant today? Ocean freight or seagoing freight is the most common form of transport for importers and exporters, accounting for 90% of goods transported globally. So, like it or not, we all consume and we all contribute to the CO2 emissions. The IMO, or the International Maritime Organization, is a United Nations specialized agency with responsibility for safety and security of shipping and prevention of marine pollution by ships. This society has set ambitious targets for stabilizing mean global temperature. To attain these targets, it has to reduce CO2 emissions to near zero by mid-century and subsequently remove CO2 from the atmosphere during the latter half of the century. With solutions such as Ellen, we have the option to significantly reduce that rate of consumption. Okay, so some of the barriers that were tackled during this project: costly batteries and rare metals. We've all heard that they can be extremely costly. Battery prices in the last 6 years have significantly decreased year on year, and that trend looks like continuing with additional further technologies in a hope to facilitate further projects like Ellen. Limited range of pure plug-in battery operation. Yes, it was a limiting factor. We solved it. Ellen, at the time, is the largest fully electric system, allowing Ellen to sail 10 times longer than any other e-ferry, some 22 nautical miles, or 40 kilometers if you're a land lover. Safety in electrical operation and maritime operation is key. You know, during the development of Ellen, we developed with the remaining partners, firefighting systems with biodegradable foam solutions to combat any fire propagation. Redundancy throughout the vessel, training, and I'm sure Sver will touch on it some more, maritime certification of battery systems. It's a new thing in the maritime world. And we have to adhere to regulations and specifications set down by the governing bodies. Energy efficiency and propulsion systems on vessels. Again, solved that. I mean, the actual energy efficiency of Ellen was predicted to be much lower than what it's turned out to be. We're now at Ellen is 85% efficient, even better than the projected numbers, which were 20 to 30% losses. Charging infrastructure and power from the grid. Ellen is I'm sure not unique, but there was some record-breaking innovations that took place during the development. One of those was the plug size for charging Ellen is 6,000 amperes with propagation barriers, which were completely bespoke to this project. So lots of innovations, lots of barriers tackled. If you could prepare the video, I'll do a short introduction. Now, islands have been stuck in a rock and a hard place regarding transit. On one hand, they require vessels for transport and trading. And on the other hand, boats and ferries running on diesel fuel pollute the air and the water of the very islands that they serve. Environmental concerns have finally gone mainstream. Industry and governments have joined forces using carbon reduced regulations and expanding range of cleaner energy alternatives. And with Ellen, we have the solution. So please, without further ado, please meet Ellen, 100% electrical ferry powered by a Leclanché battery. So thank you. So just to recap, in with some numbers, then the fully electric ship Ellen is to ferries what supercar is to series production, and indeed she's the first not to have a backup motor or diesel emergency generator on board. So she really is the Tesla of the sea. You know, instead she has the largest battery pack currently at 4.3 megawatt hours. The Danfoss drive train providing 1.5 megawatts of thrust for her maneuvering. And she covers just over 40 kilometers or 22 nautical miles between ports and charges. She will save estimated 2,000 tons of CO2 per year. And with battery service life of some 10 years, that's a lot of savings to the environment, not to mention fuel savings. So where do we go? What do we do next? And where do we go from here? As I mentioned at the start, IMO regulations have strict guidelines to reduce the emissions in maritime sector by 40% in the year 2030. I mean, maritime world, that's just around the corner. You know, the transition is underway. However, we have a long way to go. Many early adopters, such as the Nordics, Norway in particular, and Canada, are showing the way. And what does this mean for the maritime industry? Invariably, it means we will never again build ships without consideration for the emissions that are being produced. So clearly a good thing. The top infographic perhaps tells us a little bit more in words, and I'll close with that link and let that sink in a little bit. But the bottom infographic shows the forecast of battery only solutions for the next 5 years. So although we are, as I said, we're underway, you can see that the Norway are building perhaps two times as many battery vessels globally so therefore we need to step up and be counted and make a difference. Now, the technology is there. We need to grasp it for further. Hopefully you can all see the slide, but it's showing how the amount of emissions that transport is emitting compared to other industries globally. It really is quite significant.
So Dean, for the last few minutes, we have been unable to see your screen.
Okay, I do apologize.
I'm not sure if you want to just put that back up on screen.
Sure. Okay, let me just double check that. Can you see that?
Yes, we can.
You can. Can you see? Not without the notes, no?
Yes, without the notes. We're seeing the screen and we're seeing the animation.
Okay, let me just sort of back up just very, very quickly then. Yeah, so, you know, as I said, you know, with regards to emissions globally within the sector, that we have to reduce them by 40% by regulation. That's a significant way to go in a very short period of time, you know. And again, the infographic, which I'll finish with, tells a little bit more than I can say, and I think certainly from what is being built at present, the Canadians are showing the way, but they're building two times as many, certainly battery type vessels, than anybody else globally. So we all need to step up to the plate and make the difference. But as I said, to finish, the technology is there. Just a very, very briefly again, just to show you the difference with regards to transport, including shipping and aviation, of course, compared to the other industry sectors, but really significant, and we can really make the difference in our industry. So thank you, Charlene. Thank you for everybody for listening. Hopefully you managed to catch the last few slides there. We look forward to the rest of the panel discussion and to your questions. Halfdan and Sverre will, I'm sure, give you further insight into what is a wonderful vessel. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean, for such a wonderful introduction to Ellen. And I note that you refer to her as the Tesla of the sea. I would just ask the panelists as we go through to just perhaps start looking at the questions in the chat. We do have some questions here relating to the affordability of Ellen, the dispatchability of Ellen, even in larger numbers in a fleet, and how much that would cost. Of course, since we're likening Ellen to the Tesla of the sea, that is going to be an important conversation. Ladies, gentlemen, around the globe, you've heard about the technology. Definitely sounds future-proof. And not only have you heard about the technology, you know, products being optimized with optimized performance and efficiency, with an efficiency of as high as 85%, quite impressive, but you've heard about a real life example already introduced into a fleet and changing, I imagine, transforming the lives of the people in Airo. And so this is a great opportunity to introduce our second speaker as we move away from the technology in the lab and we move into the sea and the people and the land. And I am very pleased to introduce Mr. Halfdan Abrahamsen, who is the information manager at Airo Energy Lab. And Airo Energy Lab develops and manages renewable energy projects on the island of Airo, Denmark. Abrahamsen holds a master's degree in English and media and has previously been employed in the Danish state in the educational sector. However, and as you will glean from his presentation, his deep interest in environmental matters and environmental policy and philosophy has led him to Airo, where he enjoys the opportunity to mediate new environmental technologies and policies. And Halfdan, through his work and involvement in the Ellen project, is very well suited to give us some insight of the practical life of Ellen in the island of Airo. Halfdan.
Thank you for the introduction and hello to everyone around the world. I am very excited to be here. I'm very excited to talk to other islanders because we have special challenges, but we also, I think we share a common desire to do things independently and to not be dependent of the mainland where we get supplies, etc., but we try to be independent and do it on our own. And that means that innovation is something that I think happens a lot on islands. People do it their own way. And I have to say, on a personal level, I'm extremely excited to be here because I am no longer doing a bureaucratic office work, but I am actually dealing with a solution that is sailing. And typically when you have an environmental solution, you have to pay extra money to pay for it. But the special thing about Ellen is that not only does it significantly reduce our island's emissions, it's also cheaper for our operator, which is owned by the municipality. And I think it came as a bit of a surprise to many how much cheaper it is. And I can only echo what Dean said. We have moved to a new era and we're not going to go back because there's no reason to, neither financially nor environmentally. And we know what is at stake now with global climate change. So I hope to see more ferries around the world soon, just like Ellen. And I will share my slideshow here, just a second. And this is just to give you an idea about where I'm located. Denmark is a small country, the southernmost of the Scandinavian countries, just north of Germany. And I have circled the small island here called Eru. And we are only 6,000 people here. So it has been exciting for almost everyone on the island, I would say, because everyone knows what goes on everywhere. And there's a lot of pride now about Ellen and all the good connections we get from Ellen. The thing about Eru as an island is that we are really used to making things happen on our own. During the first oil crisis in the 70s, locals actually started already back then with solar panels. And to make a long story short, we now produce more than we use with electricity with our six windmills. And the sun produces 55% of our district heating. And for those who don't know, district heating is central heating station where the whole town gets warm water centrally from that. And so everyone here in Marstal, where I live, the town where I live, gets warm water from the central heating. And it's owned by locals. Both the windmills and the district heating is owned by locals. And I like to say that windmills are pretty ugly when they are owned by a big power company somewhere off on the mainland that you never see any money return. But when you own them yourself, that makes a big difference. Then they are beautiful, both because of what they mean environmentally, but also because what they mean economically. And it means that we are quite independent also in this case. And that's a good feeling. But it's a cooperative thing. Stocks are at a fixed price. There's no interest or it's not like regular stocks, but you make a little bit of money each year, but you own it yourself. And that's the important part. The transport sector on Aeru is quite a challenge. Of course, we have four ferries, municipality-owned ferries, and one of them is Ellen. But all our buildings are emission-free. Ferries and buses remain the challenge. Buses are expensive. We are now seeking funds to help buy emission-free buses, but it's a lot of money. The e-ferry also came from private initiative here on the island. Locals got together. Of course, there's a lot of sailors here on the island. And sometimes we the politicians say, yeah, there's 6,000 heads of the ferry department on Aeru. They can't do anything regarding ferries without a lot of people joining in to comment on what they think. But there was actually not too much resistance about the idea of Ellen because it just sounded so interesting, and for maritime people to be able to do something like that, that's something that sort of turns them on technologically, etc. Now, Ellen was not exactly cheap to build. On the left-hand side of the screen, you can see what we actually spent on Ellen, developing Ellen, 30 million euro altogether. And the cake there shows what we spent the money on. Now, the red part is research, development, information, and administration, just administering the project. It was a large project with 9 European partners. And the reason for that was not least that we got funding from EU's Horizon 2020 program. They support a lot of green projects. But to be able to get that funding, we actually got 15 million euros. So it was a big deal. We had to spread sort of the idea to across Europe. But that has been extremely exciting, working with so many different partners, different languages, different cultures. It has also been challenging sometimes, but exciting. And it's great to be able to share the accolades or whatever you can call it with the people around across Europe. Having said that, a new ferry is much, much cheaper. We have made an estimate that says 16 million euro for a new ferry. And we have broken down the cost. These costs are from our evaluation report. Everyone can request it. You can write to me on the email that you see on the bottom right of every screen here, and you can simply just request it, and you will be sent the evaluation report. It's quite dense and nerdy, but I think many would find it interesting. I would just like to say that that the land part is a big thing. You can't just project buying an electric ferry because it swallows a lot of electricity. So we have four 1.2 megawatt transformers. Those are huge transformers, and they deliver the power. We can actually charge in just 1 hour, which is quite amazing, actually. Elling can hold what about a household or common household in Denmark uses in during 1 year. So there's a lot of energy going in 1 hour if need be. But we don't do that because there's no reason to overtax the batteries by supercharging. So, but we charge during the night. And our charger is based on a ramp, so it follows the ferry's movements. And on the bottom of the screen, you can see the state of the charge of the batteries. They are charged at night, then we spend the energy, and when we get back to home port, then we just charge a little bit, use some more, charge a little bit when we get back again, etc. Then we have a long break where we charge again a lot. And that means that we can maintain a high frequency because we have really spare energy. But before we go to the next slide, and I think I need to wrap up pretty soon here, I would like to just show a video of the evaluation results. So if you would start the video. Okay, I hope that just gave you a brief insight into the evaluation results. In any case, one moment here. I'm just about done, time is running out, but I just want to show you here this graph about the economy that shows that a fully electric ferry is the cheapest solution. Already after 4 years, if the land part is already in place, a bit further, a bit more years if you have to build the land facilities also. I would like to just end by saying that the impact of Ellen on the island of Aeroy has been great. We get incredible amounts of contacts. People come here weekly to see the ferry. This year, government representatives from two European nations has been here to see Ellen because they want to implement something similar. And there are new jobs created. Our navigation school has the world's first e-courses or the first courses in sailing fully electric. So there are many benefits. And we are just so happy that this could happen. And I think my time is up now, or is that right?
Thank you so much, Halfdan. I'm sure our viewers and listeners would rather you continue, and I'm sure they have plenty questions that will follow your presentation. But definitely my main takeaways from this presentation is proof of what I started by saying. Really, Ellen seems to be the epitome of the triple bottom line: people, profits, and planet. So the environmental factors, the environmental saves, the impact, the positive impact on the people. You mentioned the job creation and that social benefit that comes out of it. And of course, the economics. Very interesting that you mentioned the difference in the price, the difference in the economics between Ellen as a prototype and generations or offspring of Ellen to come. That's a very noteworthy point. And as an islander myself, I note that you began really laying the context and the opportunities that exist for island states, opportunities that force us to be innovative, opportunities that force us to be creative. And as a resilient people, we really do make things happen. And I just really love the fact that in Aero, and I hope I'm saying that correctly, that there is that cooperative approach and that sense of ownership surrounding Ellen and her offspring to come. So I want to thank you for that presentation. We look forward to more from you as we proceed to the third presentation and then into the discussion bit of our panel. So thank you very, very much. And ladies, gentlemen, from across the world, you've heard about Ellen, you've seen the proof of concept, and now you've even had a chance to glean some of what is possible for the future, the replicability of Ellen. And moving into the future, looking at the future view, and this is no longer a matter of can island states and other countries replicate such a project within the next 10 years. This is really the now. And understanding that is the now, we've heard about the technology, we've heard about the infrastructural requirements to make this possible and successful. And I am very happy that the next presentation touches on another very key factor, and that is regulation. We've already touched a little on the safety required, the safety measures that are required, certification, and really all what is required to make this industry mainstream. And it is my distinct pleasure to invite to tell us about that and to benefit from his expertise, Mr. Sverre Eriksson. And Sverre is a senior principal approval engineer for electrical systems at DNVGL Maritime. Again, another huge name in the industry. Sverre Eriksson is senior principal approval engineer for DNVGL Maritime, based in Norway. And DNVGL Maritime is the world's leading classification society and a recognized advisor for the maritime industry. DNVGL Maritime enhances safety, quality, energy efficiency, and environmental performance of the global shipping industry across all vessel types and offshore structures. Sverre joined DNVGL Maritime in 2008, and he has worked with electrification of ships since 2011, being greatly a part of the evaluation and monitoring for the safety of battery installations on board many ships. He's also been responsible for developing the DNVGL class rules for battery-powered ships. Eriksson has a Master of Science degree in Electric Power Engineering from the Norwegian University of Science and Technology. Sverre?
Thank you, Charlin. So, my name is Sverre Eriksson. I'm working in a company called DNVGL. I'm located in Norway, and I have had the pleasure to be involved in several electrification of vessels. And just to be short about my company, DNVGL is a merge between the Norske Veritas and the German company Germanische Lloyds. And we do classification of vessels, so it's safe to sail. We do certification and verification and test against regulatory requirements. And we also, and that's important in this context, we do development of new rules, standard and recommended practices. And when you have a new technology like batteries that is supposed to propel the vessels, then there is, in the beginning, no rules or standards. So we had to develop our own rules together with the industry and the flag states and so on. So for Elm, it has been verified against our classification rules. In addition, we do technology qualification. So if you come up with a new battery technology or whatever it is, we can help the makers to verify the technology and see where the problems are or where the non-problems are. In addition, we also do some advisory works with respect to safety, technology, data management, cybersecurity, efficiency, and so on. So, but what about L? Is the vessel safe? That is my job in this project, or was my job in this project. So, and as I told you, there was developed class rules for doing this. And we were concerned about batteries that could be thermal instable. So we had a lot of focus on the battery installation itself. We required that we need a certification of the batteries. So for instance, we required that they should put the battery on fire. And not the whole battery, but a part of it, this start with a cell, heat it up so it's igniting, and see how the fire is spreading through the battery system. And the pass criteria was that it should stop at least within one module, a block of the battery system. And we require that they repeated the test three times. So Leclanché has to go to Finland to a fire research laboratory, and they put the batteries on fire and successfully done it three times. And it is. So if there is a fire starting inside due to a failure in a battery cell or something like that, like you had one of these Samsung batteries that caught fire on the mobile phone, or this Boeing Dreamliner planes that had this problem, then the fire will be extinguished within or will stop within the system. And of course, there is rules that you have protection of the battery system's installation on board the vessel, so that if there is an incident, the failure will be kept within that battery space. One other very important aspect is when you're running on batteries all alone, is that you know that you have sufficient capacity on your batteries. For instance, on your PC or your mobile phone, you have this small bar graph telling that you have 100% available, you have 80% available power or something like that. And of course, when your mobile laptop or whatever it is starting to getting old. You put it, you charge it, and then you charge it within 1 hour instead of 3 hours, and you get it to 100%. And that's because the capacity of the battery is not as good as it was when it was new. So you get up to 100% voltage very fast, but you actually doesn't have the correct capacity. And then this is important on board a vessel. So you need to take care of the state of health of the battery and compare the actual capacity compared to a new battery. And all these things are put in place on the Ellen ferry. So for the Ellen ferry, we have certified a lot of the components that are essential or important on board. And we have issued a class certificate, so it's a safe vessel. And in this project, we have also cooperation with the Danish Maritime Authority and worked together with them. So, and then I would like to just tell you what is happening. Here in Norway, where I'm living, there is a lot of electrification project, but there is also electrification of vessels other places around the world. So if you look at this bar graphs, back in 2011, we had two projects ongoing, and these projects are hybrid projects, and very many vessels are hybrid. So they have both batteries and diesel engines or LNG fueled engines or biodiesel engines. And the blue color is the ongoing project that are being built, and the red one is those one out sailing. So in 2013, the two first vessels were out there sailing that could be propelled by the vessels. This was hybrid vessels. And as you see now in 2020 up to now, we have 230 projects, which 120 of them are sailing and 110 of them are under building. So it's picking up a lot. And actually, there is a new project coming each week, and one project is finalized each week. So it's very cool to see this trend. So, but you never know. You know, if you have a big seagoing vessel, of course you can't propel that vessel to cross the Atlantic. So then you need to build a hybrid vessel. I would also like the opportunity to just show you some of the project we have been involved in. This Ampere ferry from Norway was put in operation in 2015. It was the first fully battery powered electric passenger and car ferry, but it did have an emergency generator that is running on diesel. The cool thing about this project was that the power grid on the shore sides were rather weak. So to help out with that, to be able to charge the vessel within 9 minutes, because that was the stop before it has to go to the other harbor, then they had to put in additional batteries. So companies like Leclanché and other battery makers are very happy when the grid is weak, because then they sell more batteries. But it does work. So then you slowly charge the shore batteries while the vessel is sailing. And when the vessel is coming back, it has enough energy stored to fast charging the ferry. Here is another vessel. Now we are moving to Iceland and to the island Vestmannaeyjar. This vessel is called Herjolve, if my Icelandic language is correct. This is a vessel that is transporting from the main line of the island, Iceland, to the island Vestmannaeyjar. And it's a place where they have a lot of fishery. So the most important thing that are on that vessel is fish, and together with the cars and passengers. And this vessel is a hybrid vessel. It is, when the weather is good, they will propel it on batteries all alone. But when it's hard or harsh weather, they will need the diesels to run in parallel. And then there is another vessel. This is a rather big vessel, almost like a cruise vessel. It's going between Sweden and Norway. This vessel is also a hybrid vessel, but it has this operation mode of zero emission. So when it's 30 minutes away from the shoreside, it turns off all the diesels and it's run on batteries all alone for the last half an hour, and then charge it while the passengers are going off and on, and then sailing out again for half an hour before the diesels are turned on. And that is very great for the local pollution. So then you can see the sun, even though maybe not shown on this picture. One last example is a sightseeing boat. It's going in a fjord on the western coast of Norway. It's maybe look more like an opera house. It could have 400 passengers. But the interesting thing here is the power dock. So you see this docking area. This is filled with batteries. So it's just like the first Ampere ferry I showed you. Here they have a combined quay and a power station. So that's a very cool solution. So that was what I was planning to tell you. Charlin?
Thank you, Sverre. Very, very interesting. And we're seeing that apart from Ellen, we have some other great examples around the world. I will go straight into questions, noting that we have half an hour, and I really want to give our participants an opportunity to pose their questions. And so I have noted some of the questions, and I'm going to start, especially since you've mentioned all these examples, and they seem to be within the European context. And for me, this question is quite relevant, being a Caribbean island girl. So this question I open to any of the panelists who may wish to answer. Is this type of transportation, these e-vessels, are they feasible for the context of small island developing states? And I know it's an ongoing conversation. So while we have proven the economy or the economics of Ellen and Ampere and these other ships, if these projects have to be scaled to meet the needs of small island developing states and their context, is it a feasible option?
Sure, Matt.
I would just like to say that yes, it is feasible. However, there's one important thing to note, and that is you need the power power grid that can deliver the kind of power without creating blackouts in communities. So that's something to notice, but otherwise I don't see a reason why it shouldn't be just as possible in even smaller islands than Aru.
Yeah, I mean, just to for me to echo both what Halfdan and Sverre have said there in the both of their presentations. The Aero ferry and Ellen itself are important, and yes, it's feasible, but without the shoreside technology and having the infrastructure shoreside, it really does it really becomes a little bit more involved. These can there's many ways to get over these with I think as you see from Halfdan's presentation, with wind and solar, but also with battery technologies on the shore side as well. In fact, in one of our latest projects in Ontario, we're doing that very same thing. So there is a weakness in the infrastructure on the shore side, and we're delivering a buffer station from that's been fed from the grid to charge batteries. And as the vessel transitions across the water, to we trickle charge the battery, and then when it comes back across, we can charge with the up to a good state of depth of discharge. Is kind of the same sort of idea as the power dock that Sverre indicated to. So a buffer station, yeah. So in essence, Charlene, it is extremely feasible.
Maybe I can also add in, if you don't go fully electric, but you go for a hybrid vessel where you have assistance of the battery and you actually charge and the batteries from the engines that are on, driven on diesels or biofuels or something, you can gain efficiency margins. So that depending on the operation, but if you have a ferry that starts and stops a lot and so on, it might be feasible also to have a hybrid vessel.
Thank you, panelists, for your responses. Our next question was incidentally about the charging infrastructure required, so the shoreside technology that is required. I believe all of you have sort of touched on that. But to just go into the next question, sort of related, how long does it take to charge Ellen? That is a question here from one of our participants.
Well, we can charge in just 1 hour. Which is quite amazing. It's called charging at 1C because we have 4.3 megawatt hour and in the batteries and can charge basically that in 1 hour. But we choose to charge not so fast. But maybe Dean, you can say something about what is good practice in charging batteries.
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, to get the longevity from the system, and we size a system for, typically in marine, and Sverre will correct me if I'm wrong, but typically we're looking at an 8 to 10 year life of these batteries. So we need to size and dimension them correctly. Now, yes, we could charge a battery system at a higher rate of charge than what we call 1C, which is 1 hour, but invariably that will reduce the capacity or life of the specific battery from perhaps 8 to 10 years to significantly reduce that. So we have to watch it. We have to make sure that is fit for purpose for the life of the asset. To ensure that operationally, the operational profile that we're given from the outset, it meets and hopefully exceeds that. So I hope that sort of kind of answered your question. There, it is specific, and we have different technologies and chemistries to meet a higher rate of charge. So if you have a water taxi or perhaps like Ampere, which is being is going across and has to charge a lot quicker, perhaps it can use a different chemistry. So we'll look at that from a chemistry point of view, actually, from the get-go, and size accordingly the battery pack for a fully electric or a hybrid solution.
Yeah. Thank you, Dean and Sverre. And we have another question here relating to a transition. So if we were to replace all the existing ships with Ellen, how do we deal with the old ships? Question that comes up when we speak about electrifying ground transport also. And a second part to that question, this question is from Umida Slevokska. Thank you for your question and thanks for joining us today. So question two from this participant is, can you power existing ships with your electrification solution? I imagine this question relates to whether or not it is feasible to retrofit existing ships to take on that electric propulsion.
I'll pitch in very quickly here. I mean, yes, in short, we cannot, a battery cannot facilitate every single vessel globally. As Sverre indicated there during his presentation, range is a factor, okay? So when we're talking about short range, and as this is an island forum, when we're talking about island nations and island states, we can utilize battery and hybrid solutions for relatively short distance. We can't cross the Atlantic, for instance. We would need sort of a combination of solutions, i.e. LNG, diesel, biofuels, and perhaps, as Sverre indicated, when we come into a harbour location or a ports and harbours, then you transition to a battery solution. And we are developing with some key partners that very sort of solution, where we will utilize the battery for the last half an hour or last 40 minutes, or in fact when a vessel is in a port and harbor. So we're not, if you're in a beautiful place like Venice, for argument's sake, or for argument's sake in the Caribbean on a cruise vessel, then you're not seeing plumes of dark black smoke coming out of the funnel. We can ultimately reduce and negate that utilizing alternative fuels.
Yes, maybe I can also fill in. What we have seen so far is the 230 projects I told you about, and about 30% of them are retrofit projects, where they do put in batteries to make the vessels hybrid. And that is to make the possibility for a zero emission operation, but also for peak shaving to just reduce fuel consumption. But of course you need a vessel that are fit for putting in a battery. So if you have electric propulsion in the beginning, it's much easier than if you have an old directly driven propeller from a diesel engine.
And maybe just, sorry, yeah, go on.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, maybe just to add some weight to, I think what Sverre was saying there is that a life of an asset or a life of a vessel could be 35, 40 years, depending on how many people and how many companies may own it over that period of time from it being new built. So the regulations invariably will change. And as I said, the International Maritime Organization has hit really one achievable targets, but something that we have to do. And, Halfdan mentioned it, it's better for us. It's better for the people. It's better for profit, and it's better for the planet. We have to do it. We have to go there. Yeah. So we can retrofit solutions, and over the life of a 30, 40 year asset, it's quite feasible to do so. Yeah. One, because it's a carrot and a stick situation. The carrot says, look, it's feasible to do so, and it's better for the planet, for the people, and for profit. But also the regulatory body says, here's the stick. You must do this. You cannot continue to sail this vessel in the same sort of state that it is 20 years ago. Yeah. So it's kind of, yes. We can hybridize, electrify, but also retrofit current vessels.
And I just want to note that Ellen was designed from the get-go to be extremely hydrodynamic and lightweight. And that means that if you retrofit an old ferry, for instance, a couple of our old ferries we call shoeboxes, they are short and wide because when they were built, the number of crew that you had to sail with was determined by the length of the vessel, which is incredibly unfortunate for energy use, because then you have to push so much water. Ellen is basically designed, inspired with inspiration from old sailing ships that glide through the water. And so you can't expect the same performance as we get on Ellen on a retrofit. However, I will concur I will completely agree with what Dean said, that we have to do things differently now. And if that means having an electric retrofit, which doesn't perform quite as well as Ellen, well, that's too bad. At least we reduced emissions, and we have to do that. So I'm all for it.
Thank you, gentlemen. And while we're on the topic still of the technology, because I do want to move a little into a question that we have concerning battery storage as opposed to hydrogen. But before that, just taking advantage of where we're at now in the discussion, we do have a question on the life cycle of the batteries, the materials used. So I do know that LN, the materials used for LN include steel, aluminum, and even on your deck, recycled paper. Is that, did I read correctly? So the question here is, what happens to them? And that is, that includes the batteries and also these materials that are used to develop LN. What happens to them after the life cycle is over?
Dean, can you
say certainly something? Yes, of course. I mean, the Sverre touched on it very briefly in his discussion with regards to the state of health of a battery. You know, after a period of time, the state of health may be reduced to 80 or 75%. That doesn't mean that it's done and it's ready to be scrapped. Yeah, it can be reused. It can be used or repurposed. Yeah. It may not be able to drive LN the same way that it did in year one. But there's still a significant volume of energy and capacity left in that to repurpose for whatever the case may be. Additionally, in previous battery technologies, lead acid batteries are 99.9% recyclable. This is a new technology. Yeah, we will get there with regards to recycling the batteries and the repurposing and recycling of these is certainly stage one, but we're progressing. And I think from a Leclanché point of view, we've already have partners to within our portfolio and that we are aligned to that can deal with that in the most beneficial way for the for people, planet, and profit, as Charlene says. I love that.
And if I can add in an ALU context, we are actually now in a research project with the local university, or the most local university we have to see if we can and build a smart grid in Sibri, where Ellen resides, because a lot of people have solar panels privately on their homes. They have small wind solutions. And then we also have Ellen with a lot of batteries. And those batteries that no longer would be relevant for use on Ellen, they could be used as a power bank to power the batteries. However, it's something that takes expert engineering skills to do. We can't do it ourselves, but we are very interested in the possibilities. There's no reason to throw away batteries like that.
But I think it's important to know when you are reaching the end of the battery and you're not reusing it more. You need to recycle it. You need to dismantle it. You need to take out the copper and the different materials. And as I have understood, the experience from the car industry and the car batteries, it still costs more to reuse the minerals than the price you get from selling the minerals or the metals that you have in the batteries. So there is somebody talking about that maybe there should be a kind of deposit when you buy such a battery. You have to maybe put some dollars in so that when it's going to be deposit, it in a way is financed from the first part. But of course, that's a political issue.
So a perfect follow-up question is, one, is LN designed to allow for easily replaceable batteries? And even moving beyond LN, are you designing these vessels to allow for easily replaceable batteries so that new innovations in batteries can easily be swapped in, as well as empowering the fast swap of batteries when in port?
Yeah, I mean, I think I can probably answer that question. Since Ellen, the technology. It's not stopping, put it that way. It's continually evolving. And the capacity actually that we develop now in our current cell, in our current module, is about 20%, 25% more than what was put into Ellen at the forefront, at the conception of the system. That's in the same module size, so the same frame size, the same battery, same size of battery pack. I'm holding up a phone there, in the same envelope, if you like. We are getting 20 to 25% more. And that's almost year on year increase due to the technology and due to different chemistries, et cetera, et cetera. So in answer to the question, we delivered, I think, 820 50 kilo batteries that make up the 4.3 megawatt hours of Ellen. We delivered that with what we call a 40 amp hour cell. In 2021, we're at 65 amp hour cell. So significant increase, yeah? 30% increase. So basically, if we were to build Ellen now, backward compatible, we're getting something like six megawatt hours. It's really quite significant. And that continues to cycle onwards. And not only that, Charlin, but the reduction in cost is quite significant year on year. So it's becoming more and more feasible in a smaller capacity. So I hope that answers the question in part.
Yeah, I think I would just extend the question to looking at easier management and deployment. So as it stands, does Ellen allow for that removability of batteries?
I often guide people on the Ellen, and I'm often asked, so where is the battery? Where can I see the battery? But it's not one battery. It's basically, it looks like a very large car battery, and they unrack. And so you can actually, you cannot just pull it out, but you can pull one out and insert a new one back in pretty easily. They are water cooled, so there are pipes running, etc. But it's not like we have to split the whole ship and open it up or anything. We can just replace individual modules.
On Ellen in particular, there is a hatch where we can get down to the battery space, so we can bring out quite significant amount of modules very quickly and replace, you know, during the midnight hours or during early morning hours to so that we don't impact operations very, very quickly.
Thanks, that definitely was useful. So I'm going to move a little away from the battery technology. And we have a question here that notes that Denmark has high amounts of wind power. And I think, Halfdan, you would have presented that in your presentation. So the question related to that is, has hydrogen been considered, and why not use hydrogen as the storage medium, given that wind capacity that you have, as opposed to what has been pursued with Ellen in terms of battery technology?
Well, I know this is a hot potato in the area of emission-free technology, hydrogen or batteries, and I'm not an expert, I'm not an engineer, but the energy efficiency of Ellen's battery system is 85%. I don't think you would ever reach that with hydrogen. Also, you have to you have to refine it. You have to transport it. You have to store it. We have our six windmills out here. Cables underground, the power runs right to the transformer station and right into Ellen. It's really quite simple. And for short sea shipping, as we call it, I don't see a reason to go hydrogen, really, because of all the extra things you have to consider and the energy efficiency. But there's a new project now with a private company building and a ferry sailing from Ehud to northern Germany, and the range is going to be farther than is probably going to be feasible with batteries now. So that's going to be hydrogen. I'm looking forward to see how it works, but currently I just don't see the reason to go hydrogen. We produce more wind than we need. Why waste energy converting it to something when we could just charge Ellen directly? So
maybe I could add in there. I think that hydrogen is a reasonable solution when you have a long distance travel, because you can't charge that much energy in batteries. So for longer distance, that is an option. A fuel cell, hydrogen driven fuel cell, would typically have an efficiency of 50%, and you will have the same the other way around when you use electricity to make hydrogen. So the efficiency as such is rather low compared to use the electricity directly. But you can't have eons of batteries installed, so then the hydrogen could be a solution. And I know also now they are looking into use ammonia as an alternative to hydrogen. It's looked upon as a little more safe, even though it's quite explosive, that also.
Mm-hmm. We're at Leclanché with our partners, we are looking into a hydrogen hybrid, as both Sverre and Halfdan said, to extend range, you know, on a vessel in Scotland into Orkney. So, and again, purely as a range extender, so it has battery and hydrogen fuel cell combination.
Okay, thank you, and I'm going to pedal back and sort of revisit a question I was previously asked, because it's coming up again in the small island developing state context, given that there are fears that we suffer from economies of scale. And so the requirements of such small islands are perhaps you would typically need vessels that are smaller than Ellen. So that is part one of my question. We already did answer that, yes, they can be feasible for small island developing states, but in terms of economies of scale, how much does that affect the small island scenario where you may need a ferry that holds 50 people and perhaps no cars, to be specific? And the second part to that question is, particularly in that context and in general, what is the cost of technology like Ellen versus the traditional fuel driven vessels? So this question here, looking at the CapEx versus and OPEX and a life cycle cost comparison, which I believe Halfdan would have already given us some insight into.
I will just say that in our evaluation report, we have compared Ellen, the cost of building a new Ellen, with the cost of building a new diesel. And I will just try to find it now because I can't remember the number. But building a new Ellen is no longer significantly more expensive than building a diesel. Buying a whole fleet at one point, I don't know. Maybe Dean, you can give discounts if they buy a really big load of batteries, but I'm not quite sure to what to answer to that.
Sure, I mean I think maybe as you try to bring up that snapshot, I mean maybe the one of the questions in retort to that, Charlin, is what's the cost of not doing it? Yeah, what is the cost of not doing it? We really need to make, and again we cannot continue in the same vein in the maritime sector to emit the significant fuel and CO2 emissions that we are doing. It is comparatively, if we're talking about in comparison to a car, then the battery system, I can speak about the battery system, of course, but the battery system is not as cheap as it would be for a car. But and that's part of the reason is we have specific regulations to meet and safety of many, many people. And you know, Sper could wax lyrical about that. But again, it's down to I think as the battery technology and capacity increases and the cost comes down, then it's more and more feasible. We cannot, but we will not, and we have to look at total cost of ownership of a vessel, you know, in the 30, 35 years. And maybe just to touch on, you know, economies of scale, we're looking at Ellen as a 4.3 megawatt hour system. We can also deliver batteries for outboards, for smaller systems, for two or three people. You know, this, it will become more and more the norm, yeah, as the technology price reduces significantly.
All right, so our next question again applies to all island nations, but in particular small island developing nations that are subject to harsh weather conditions and the most negative and adverse effects of climate change. So this question here is, what is the highest wind speeds that she can safely sail in? And that's referring to Ellen. And how does she perform in severe weather?
If I can just go back, we have made a calculation saying that a new type diesel called LNG 50 would cost 14 million euros and a new e-ferry series would cost 16.7 million euros. So we're talking 15% more expensive to buy Ellen. But that extra expense, like I said, is earned pretty quickly, and the life cycle costs are clearly on the e-ferry side. With regards to wind, what sets the limit is the amount of bath bags that the passengers are going to use if we don't stay in port in really high winds. But it's not because Ellen can't handle it, it's just because the passengers can't handle it.
Interesting. Thank you very much. And just noting the time, I want to give the panelists an opportunity to leave us with some brief remarks, some closing remarks, your main takeaways, but most importantly, what you want our participants to walk away from this panel remembering, if nothing else.
Since I'm already unmuted, I would like to say that before I started working with Ellen, I was one of those people who actually felt like this world was not going to end up a great place within not too many years. Now that I'm working with Ellen and I see the solution, I see the reduction that is available. All our buildings, et cetera, here are emission free. The last remaining hurdle is the ferries. We don't have planes on the island, except for a single small one, but the ferries can basically take away the island's emissions. And that means we have to invest in Ellen four times altogether. So I want to say there's a solution. The solutions are becoming cheaper, and maybe we will save this world after all.
Wonderful. Dean?
Yeah, sure. I mean, the transition has started. You know, conventional technologies are still going to be around, but they are transitioning away, and we cannot continue to continue the way that we have behaved, you know, in previous years. As I was trained 30 years ago as an electrical marine engineer, We were trained on diesel engines and steam engines, and we're not there now. We have the technology ready. We're proving it in places like Norway and Canada, and other places around the world are grasping this technology. It's not a state of experimentation anymore. This is the new now. Yeah. We will grasp it. You know, if you said what was the number one car in America or in Americas, you would not say 5-10 years ago it was a Tesla or some, you know, or some hybrid. You wouldn't be there. We're going the same way with the maritime world.
Thank you, and Sfera.
Yes, I think that it's important to know that a battery-driven vessel is as safe as a traditional vessel, provided that it's designed correctly. And of course, the environmental footprint is much better.
Thank you. And thank you so much to our participants. You've been an awesome audience, virtual participation at its best. I hope we have answered most, if not all, of your questions. And I'm sure that now you're convinced, just as I am, that we had the best of the best on this panel. Let me take the opportunity again to recognize the efforts of Leclanché, the sponsors of this session, and likewise the organizers of this summit, James and his team at Island Innovation. Job well done, guys. Thank you.
Thank you so much.